Here we look at oxygen consumption rate during exercise. We'll be plotting oxygen consumption, or VO2, as a function of time, indicating the exact points at which the exercise begins and ends. And we're going to do it in two scenarios, graph A, non-maximal exercise, and graph B, much more intense, exercise at VO2 max or beyond. Let's go ahead and jump into graph A, non-maximal exercise. From the instant the activity begins, VO2 starts to climb, ultimately leveling off at what we call steady rate VO2. Some people say a steady state condition has been achieved. More about that in a moment. But before that occurs, we develop an oxygen deficit. That's this area. And what that represents is a situation in which the now active muscle cells, because they haven't had enough time yet to produce ATP aerobically, must resort to anaerobic means to satisfy their energy requirements. High energy phosphate molecules like ATP and creatine phosphate that were previously produced and stored in the sarcoplasm, they're being used now. Glycolysis is taking place, which is anaerobic. This all builds this oxygen deficit. It develops while activity is occurring and will ultimately have to be reconciled. Now, the steady rate VO2, seen here, is a point where we have very nice balance between the cell's abilities to produce ATP aerobically and the ATP requirements to sustain activity. This could be sustained for a long period of time. We may not do so, but it could be. Things get interesting when we discontinue exercise. Note that the VO2 falls, but it does not fall instantaneously to resting levels. It falls in a more gradual fashion. The reason for this lag, and we call this recovery VO2, excess post-exercise oxygen consumption, or EPOC. Some people even say an oxygen debt's being repaid now. This is a period during which oxygen shortfalls, which accumulate during activity, must now be cleared. And this is going to have to be cleared aerobically. We need to do things during this time, like eliminate lactic acid that may have been produced. Need to reconvert to pyruvic acid and then glucose, ultimately maybe glycogen. We need to restore our stored ATP and creatine phosphate levels in the sarcoplasm. We need to repair muscle fibers that may have been damaged during activity. We even need to replenish our venous blood O2 levels to what they were pre-exercise and get body temperature back to normal. All this requires energy, and it's going to have to be satisfied aerobically. Notice that the slope of the recovery curve is affected by exercise intensity. So the higher the exercise intensity was, the more gradual the slope is going to be. Now, jump down and look at graph B, higher level of activity. Let's start out here with VO2 max. This is a level of activity, of exercise, at which the aerobic capacity of the system is at its ultimate. We can't do better than that, theoretically. So we're basically pushing the limit as far as we can. That's VO2 max. Notice that VO2 max, quantitatively, is higher than it was up here under our non-maximal exercise condition. Why the difference? Well, that's easy. We're now exercising more intensely. We're actually exercising at the limit, VO2 max. We're building a more substantial oxygen deficit during this time, a more substantial oxygen debt. And should we decide to push the limit or beyond the limit and exercise above VO2 max, we can do that, but it's going to require anaerobic processes, glycolytic ATP production, and that will ultimately build the oxygen deficit. Will have to be repaid later on.